हेलो, वेलकम टू द नॉलेज डोमेन, द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ लाइफ साइंसेस एंड बायोटेक्नोलॉजी। इन दिस लेक्चर सीरीज वी आर गोइंग टू फोकस ऑन द रेस्पिरेशन। सो बिफोर गोइंग इनटू द डिटेल्स, वी शुड नो व्हाट आर द टाइप्स ऑफ द और द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ द रेस्पिरेशन। द फर्स्ट वन इज द पल्मोनरी वेंटिलेशन दैट डील्स विद द इनफ्लो एंड द आउटफ्लो ऑफ द एयर विद इन द एटमोस्फियर एंड द लॉन्ग एल्वियोली। सो दिस इज द जॉब ऑफ द लॉन्ग्स। Then the diffusion of oxygen that is taken from the atmosphere and the carbon dioxide that is generated at the byproduct or the of the cellular metabolism. The exchange of these gases takes place between the alveoli and the blood. Then the transport of O2 and the CO2 in the blood and the body fluid to and from the body tissue of the cells. It means the O2 that will be from the atmosphere that is diffused into the blood will be carried to each and every cells of the body, and the CO2 that is produced as a byproduct of the metabolism, that is the waste of the metabolic activity in the tissues, in the cells, that will be carried from those parts into the lungs, and that will be finally excreted into the atmosphere. So the transport takes place of O2 and the CO2 between the lung and the various tissues. Then the regulation of the ventilation and other facets of the respiration. So first one is the pulmonary ventilation, the exchange of the atmospheric gases with the alveolar gases. Next is the diffusion in the alveoli of the oxygen and CO2 between the alveolar air and the blood. Then the transport of O2 and the CO2 between the respiratory epithelium of the lungs and the tissues where the CO2 is generated or O2 is going to be used, and the regulation of this entire process, the ventilation or the other facets of the respiration. So for the contraction and the expansion of the thoracic cage, so the lung is floated in the pleural cavity. So it is not attached to any of the portions of the thorax, but it is suspended in the pleural cavity. So it is surrounded by the fluids. Okay. So this is expiration. So everything contracts, like the abdominal muscles, they contracted so that the space in the thorax will be reduced, so that whatever air is there, that will be expelled out. And inspiration, the important muscles are the intercostal muscles, external intercostal, internal intercostals, and the rib cage. So the expansion of these both in the height as well as the, in the width. So the entire volume of the pleural cavity increases so that the lungs will expand, so that air, atmospheric air will be inhaled. And finally, it will reach to the alveoli. So the importance of the diaphragm is also there. For the thoracic cage, diaphragm and the muscles, the intercostal muscles are responsible for inspiration. Okay, so next is the, I just discussed in the previous slides about the pleural cavity where the lungs is suspended. So there is a alveolar pressure, that means the pressure found in the alveoli of the lungs, and there is a pleural pressure. So it is, if the pleural pressure is almost minus 0.5 atmospheric or the centimeter of the water, and the, this is the alveolar pressure. So the difference between the pleural pressure and the alveolar pressure result in the net negative pressure, the transpulmonary pressure. So that is the difference between the pleural pressure and the alveolar pressure. So this corresponds with the lung volume. So when this is the highest, means 1 to minus 7, then you can see the lung volume is the highest. So if the negative pressure inside the lung, that is the product of the difference between the pleural pressure and the alveolar pressure is highest, then the lung volume is Yes, that means the maximum air is already inhaled and the one that difference decreases, then the lung volume also decreases. So the transpulmonary pressure directly corresponds with the lung volume. So elastic forces of the lungs, that is responsible for the change in the volume of the lung. One is the lung tissue, elasticity of the lung tissue, or the elastic force responsible for the lung tissue. And the second one is the elastic force caused by the surface tension of the fluid that line the inside wall of the alveoli and other lung airspaces. So one is the elastic force of the lung tissue, and the second one is the surface tension of the fluid that is lying. That also we will discuss in the respiratory episode. So these are the two important elastic forces that is very much responsible in defining the transpulmonary pressure or the volume of the lung. So in this case, we can see that the lung volume change in the liter. So this is the expiration. So when it is expiration, the change in the lung volume, and this is the in the inspiration, this is the change in the lung volume. So the pleural pressure, when it is -5, in the inspiration, you can see the difference in the transpulmonary pressure, it is the highest here. So this is a situation when this is the like this, air-filled alveoli. So here you can see take is the -4 to minus, this is starting from the -4 to this is -8. So this is expiration, inspiration, and this is the change in the lung volume. But when instead of air, this is saline filled, you see the pleural pressure, it is very less because the surface tension is not possible once the alveoli is the filled with any liquid in it. So because of that, the lung volume change is very less and there cannot be any inhalation possible in this case once the lung is filled with the saline. Respiratory occurs on during a normal breathing. So this wave, like the character or the schematic we can see here, this is a normal tidal volume, means without any effort the normal breathing, that is also almost 500 ml, and it is called the tidal volume. So normal breathing when there is no exercise and there is no stress means completely normal. So the tidal volume is almost 500 ml. So once a person inspired, means whatever the normal inspiration, then the person can forcefully try to inhale maximum air it can. So that is known as the inspiratory reserve volume, means lung has the space, but it is not in use in the normal breathing. So the maximum air that can be inhaled by forceful inspiration, that is the inspiratory reserve volume, that is above the tidal volume, and this is almost 3000 ml. Then there is the expiratory reserve volume, this one. So you expire, then you try to forcefully expire as much as air you can. So that is the expiratory reserve volume, the opposite of the inspiratory reserve volume. So this is the voluntary amount of the air that can be inhaled or that can be completely exhaled. The vital capacity 500 ml, the inspiratory reserve volume, as well as the expiratory reserve volume. These three of them combinedly, it is known as the vital capacity. Means a person can intentionally inhale or exhale this amount of the air. And the inspiratory capacity is, means the normal tidal volume plus the inspiratory reserve volume is the inspiratory capacity. Then there is the another one, that means the air we cannot exhale, that is the residual volume that is already present in the lungs and it cannot be exhaled by the forceful expiration also. So this expiratory reserve volume and the residual volume, both of them together, they were known as the functional residual capacity. It means it is there in the lung, but it is not in use in a regular basis. When the person is not in exercise or it is not in stress, so this is not in use, this volume of the lungs. So this expiratory reserve volume is almost 1100 ml and the residual volume is almost 1200 ml. So total lung capacity is almost 5.8 liter. Okay, so what are the terminology here? Tidal volume, the normal breathing, inspiratory reserve volume, expiratory reserve volume, residual volume. Then inspiratory capacity, functional residual capacity. Okay. Next is the vital capacity and finally the total lung capacity. So these are the respiratory passage. This is the conchia. So from the nasal aperture to the pharynx, then to the glottis, then larynx or the vocal cord, then the trachea, and finally it reaches to the alveoli. And this is the place in the alveoli which is lined with, or it is highly vascularized. So there is the exchange of the O2 and the CO2 takes place. That will be discussed in detail in following slide. So what is the physics of gas diffusion and the gas partial pressure? It is based on the Henry's laws. So partial pressure equal to concentration of the dissolved gases by solubility coefficient. That is the partial pressure. So partial pressure is expressed at atmospheres. 1 atmosphere pressure equal to 760 of mercury on the surface of the sea. Okay. So solubility coefficient, that is for the oxygen, is 0.024. Carbon dioxide is 0.57. Carbon monoxide 0.018. Nitrogen 0.012. Helium 0.008. Okay. So this is the partial pressure of the various gases that we can discuss. That means in the atmospheric air, it is at the sea. The N2 is 597, O2 is 159, CO2 it is very less in percentage, 0.04, so it is 0.3. Water is 3.7. So total is 760 mmol. So this is their contribution of each of the gases. So this will remain constant because the gas distribution may change, but the total pressure will be remain constant. 1 atmospheric pressure is the 760 mmol. Then this is the humidified air. So in the humidified air, the water vapor is composition increases from the 3.7 to 47, that means meter mercury, and the CO2 is as it is 0.3, and this O2 it is reduced to 149.3, and the N2 is 563.2. This is the alveolar air, means which is lined with the blood capillaries. The N2 is for 569, the O2 it is further reduced to 104 because the contribution of the CO2 is very high in the alveolar area. So this is the 40 milliliter of mercury is the CO2. Then 47 is the water because it is very humidified. So it is 47, like the humidified air. Then in the expired air, so this is the water, it is as usual humidified, so 47. The CO2 is slightly less because it is mixing on the way, because there is a residual volume and there is a dead air space. So this 40 is diluted, and the oxygen is increased from the 104 to 120, and the N2 is 566. So the CO2 partial pressure is highest in the alveolar air, that is 40. Okay. And the oxygen partial pressure is 120 in the expired air and 104, that is the lowest in the alveoli. So next is the effect of the alveolar ventilation and the alveolar partial pressure of the O2. So functional residual capacity we discussed in the previous slide, it is 2.3 liter. And we discussed 500 ml is the tidal volume, but it is almost 350 ml of new air is brought into the alveoli with each normal inspiration, that is 1/7 of this functional residual capacity. So in one breath, all the air that is present in the lung cannot be replaced. So it is the continual breathing that try to expire whatever air is present in the lungs. Okay. So this is the concentration of the gas, or the original concentration, and this is how long it takes. Okay. So this is the time. So this is the normal alveolar ventilation. This is the half of the alveolar ventilation. This is the two times the alveolar ventilation. So we can see that when this is double the alveolar ventilation, then the time to replace the 50% of the gas present in the alveoli, it is 0.8 seconds. It is almost 8 seconds. In the normal, it is almost 18 seconds. And when it is half the normal alveolar ventilation, it is 32 seconds. It means, depending on the rate of the alveolar ventilation, it needs corresponding amount of the time in replacing the corresponding volume of the alveolar air. So to replace the 50% of the alveolar air, the double the alveolar ventilation, it takes 8 seconds. Normally it takes 18 seconds. And when it is half, it will take slightly longer time, 32 seconds. Okay. So this is the, in the respiratory epithelium, there are the two rate of the oxygen absorption, 250 ml O2 per minute, and here it is 1000 ml O2 per minute. So this is the alveolar ventilation. So this is from the, it is a continuous increasing liter per minute. So you can see it is 4.5 liter per minute is the normal alveolar ventilation. In this case, partial pressure of O2 is almost 104, right? That we know. And here the normal rate of absorption of the O2 is 250 ml per minute. So how the alveolar pressure of O2 is determined? One is the ventilation, another is the rate of absorption in the respiratory epithelium. So when it is the normal 250 ml per minute, it is almost 4.5 liter per minute of the alveolar ventilation. That will keep this 104. But when the rate of absorption of the O2 is 1000, four times of this, we need the higher rate of alveolar ventilation. Okay, so higher rate of alveolar ventilation, this is almost 20 liter per minute. So the absorption of the oxygen and the rate of the ventilation, it determines the alveolar partial pressure of the oxygen. Similarly, the excretion of the CO2 in the alveoli, as well as the rate of ventilation, determine the partial pressure of CO2 in the alveolar air. Okay. So the rate at which the excess gas in the alveoli is normally removed. That is the focus of this data. Next is that the slow replacement of the alveolar air is of particular importance, because that is to prevent sudden change in the gas concentration in the blood. So there are some instances where there is a perturbation in the type of the ventilation. So to avoid sudden change in the gas concentration in the alveoli, this process is adopted. Next is the CO2 partial pressure in the alveoli. So this is the alveolar partial pressure, and this is the alveolar ventilation. So in the previous slide also I have discussed the rate of the excretion. So the CO2 partial pressure will be determined by the rate of excretion of the CO2 as well as the rate of ventilation. So here the rate of excretion of CO2 is 800 ml CO2 per minute, and this is the normal 200 ml CO2 per minute. When it is the 200 ml CO2 per minute, the alveolar ventilation is low. Okay. So when the alveolar ventilation is increasing, then only it is able to reduce the partial pressure of the CO2 when the rate of excision is 800 ml per minute. So for the when the rate of excision is low, the partial pressure of CO2 is also low in the alveoli, and the rate of ventilation suddenly very sharply decreasing the partial pressure of the CO2. So when the excision increases, so to reduce the partial pressure of CO2 in the alveolar area, the rate of ventilation also has to be increased. So this is the objective. For low excision, we need the less rate of ventilation. For the high excision, to reduce the partial pressure of CO2 in the alveolar area, high rate of alveolar ventilation is needed. Okay, so based on this, we can summarize this, that this is the pressure of the O2 and CO2. So this is the dead air space, means the atmospheric air space. We know that partial pressure of O2, because it is 20.86%, 149 almost milliliter mercury, whereas it is very less in case of the CO2. Dead air space, where there is no exchange of gases takes place, like the trachea, all the bronchioles, where there is no exchange of the gases, that is the dead air space. That means the distribution of the gases in this area is almost like the atmospheric distribution of the gases. And this is the alveoli. So in the alveoli, partial pressure of CO2 is 40 millimeter mercury and the oxygen is 104 millimeter mercury. So in between the dead space and the alveolar area, the space of the lung, there is a gradual difference or the gradual change in the partial pressure of the O2 and the CO2. So this is the intermediate zone in the lungs of the alveolar area and the dead air space. So very easy to remember the dead air space or the dead space here. It is the places where there is no exchange of the gases takes place, or it is not close to the alveoli where the exchange of the gases takes place. And this is the area close to the alveoli. So this is the arrangement. So this is the terminal bronchiole, okay. Then this is the respiratory bronchiole, where you can find these are the alveolar sacs. So coming to the next one, this is the respiratory epithelium. So these are the alveoli. So this is spherical. In this case, it is a two-dimensional structure. So you can see these are the blood vessels in the transverse section. Okay. So this is the alveoli. This is the vein. This is the artery. And this is piercing. So alveoli, these are the capillaries. This is the bigger vein. This is the bigger artery. These are the lymphatic vessels. So there is the lymphatic supply to the alveoli. There is a lymphatic supply to the respiratory membrane also. This is the perivascular interstitial space. Interstitial space is the space between the cells in the tissues. So there is an interstitial space, there is the alveoli, there are the capillaries, okay, there is the artery, veins, and the lymphatic vessels. Then coming to the respiratory epithelium. So here, this is the red blood cell. These capillaries, okay. So in this capillary, you have the endothelium. This is the endothelium layer or the epithelium of the capillaries, okay. Then the adjacent, the epithelium has to sit on the basement membrane. So this is the basement membrane of the capillary. So between this, there is an interstitial space, this interstitial space. Then after that, there is the alveolar epithelium. So this alveolar epithelium also has to sit on the basement membrane. So this is the epithelial basement membrane. And this is the surfactant layer that we have discussed in one of the previous slides. So this is the respiratory epithelium. This is found in the alveoli of the lungs. So the gases has to diffuse or cross this respiratory epithelium. So the O2 has to go from the alveoli to the hemoglobin or the blood, and the CO2 has to come from the blood into the alveoli. Thank you.